What's up, y'all? Where's Brooklyn at? Good. We did not choose a single hashtag for the night, and I just wanted to put it up to the people. Is it gonna be Judatunde or Barajuda? Clap for Judatunde. Clap for Judatunde. Where you at? Did someone just boo? We are not off to a conciliatory, open, and vulnerable spot, my brother. Let's be positive. Barajuda? You cool with that, Judah?
Hey, whatever you want, you know. It's your choice to do whatever hashtag you want.
All right, Barajuda it is. Welcome. It's good to be back here at Brooklyn Historical Society. As Marcia said, we are going to be talking to each other, asking some questions. We'll involve you guys through the cards. I think I want to start asking you, why are you here? Why is this happening?
Oh, yeah. Well, I was here, I think, in September or August for the Brooklyn Book Festival, and I had a new book out, and my book is it's a book of drawings and cartoons that I did, and a lot of them are comedy, but a lot of them are very kind of, heavy satire on, I don't call it political comedy, because to me that's kind of like, you know, what does this candidate have to say to get these votes? But more like just commentating on, you know, doing satire on serious issues involving classism, racism, sexism, and corporatization of the city. A lot of them dealt with that. And then some of them, like I said, are meant to be funny. Some of them are meant to be, they're not supposed to be funny. It's like more of like a serious, you know, like a dramatic punchline. Right. Drawing gives across, and then afterwards they were talking about me. They liked a lot of things I had said, and they said, "Would you like to come back and do like a serious talk about some subject?" I'm like, "Yeah, great. I like talking to people." So,
and I'm people.
Yeah, and then I think one day she called me up. She's like, "Baratunde wants to do it." And I'm like, "Great, let's go." So I think they told me about it like, I don't know, 8 months ago, and here we are. So yeah, pretty cool.
Cool. My version of events is a little different. I was playing Pokemon Go, and it led me to this room. And I got like 4 Pokemon in the backstage area, so I'm crushing it right now. I had heard about doing an event with Judah, and I get excited. I truly do. It depends on the type of person. You'll see why I'm going to get excited. But I do get excited when white people want to talk about race.
I love talking about it. You know, the past about 5 years or so in my stand-up act, I've been doing stand-up, you know, I'm 47, I've been doing it since I was 19, and that's, even though I've done acting and other things, that's like my home base, and that's what I do every night. And about 5 years ago, I started doing shows overseas in Europe, in several different countries, and I started to see, and I was always into, you know, human rights and things like that. I remember, you know, when I'm a little kid, I'm probably like 4 or something, I'm going to some protest with my mom, you know, when I was a kid. And even in my book, I have a couple drawings. One is of an imprisoned Polish human rights leader, Lech Walesa, and I did that when I was 10. I was doing like political cartoons. So I was always kind of into that. And in my stand-up, most of the time has not, you know, for most of it, has not really dealt that heavy with big issues, mm-hmm. but more recently it has, and it kind of happened when I started going overseas to perform, because it's almost like if you're in a bad relationship, your friends can all see it, but you can't see it, you know. So initially, when I was traveling doing shows, I thought I was going to learn more about other countries. I actually started to see my own country better. Right. So you know, it gives you that perspective.
It's like you left home for the first time and realized maybe.
Yeah,
we're not number one at anything. Maybe my parents aren't the greatest parents of all time.
Right, because that's one myth that if you watch any kind of regular TV news, it's from the so-called left and the right, they will both give you that thing, like, you know, when it comes to the election, we are electing the leader of the free world. And it's like, well, why is America the only country voting for the leader of the free world? That seems a little fucked up. Something seems wrong there. You know, so, you know, a lot of people, I notice with every issue, they always try to like make it good guys and bad guys, mm-hmm. and I think it's a lot more nuanced than that. Sometimes it's bad guys and bad guys, fighting
bad
to run the country,
guys, yeah.
You know. So, and then, you know, the past few years, you know, I think I was talking to a friend of mine, comic Ted Alexandro, mm-hmm. and I remember several years ago going to him to the couple of the Occupy Wall Street protests, and he was down there in a lot more than I was, and we were talking and saying how, you know, I think we're like in the middle of or the start of another civil rights era movement, yeah. You know, and then Black Lives Matter protests, I guess, starting probably
nice
a couple years ago.
Thank you.
Yeah, I got this off their website, their Facebook page. I don't know, can't
the
remember
the official
when.
One, yeah.
But anyways, you know, it's like, well, we were talking about this some, where it's like, I just find it weird that, you know, if people expect change, how can you expect change to happen if only the group that's being oppressed is speaking up about it?
And that's why we're here.
Yeah,
that's
you know,
why we're
so.
Here. So this is the type of white person I'm happy to talk to this about
yeah.
with.
Yeah.
Not the Twitter alt-right loudmouth type. And I think it's, you know, so you talk about having, for much of your stand-up career, not dived into these issues as much in the past 5 years, especially turning this up a bit.
Yeah,
more
some of it might right? also have be having like hardly any friends, so I just
right.
watch the news all the time, and I'm like, fuck, and then I just
and see,
then I just
was,
stay at home and I read the news all
yeah.
the time. I'm like, oh shit, you know, and then you get news from, you know, better sources than the corporate news, and mm-hmm. you're like, oh wow, you know. So it just kind of consumes you.
My approach to this topic was different because I was born black and I had a lot of friends.
You don't
and
so it's just like an earlier insertion
yeah.
point.
I don't think I ever had a lot of friends, actually. Yeah,
yeah.
I was always kind of alone.
That's my privilege. I had friend yeah. privilege.
Yeah.
I understood the world through them and could reflect off of that. So yeah, there is an exhaustion that comes from, and something expected that comes from like being a black guy talking about race, and that there's a way to tune that out
mm-hmm.
by a certain crowd where it's like, well, of course that's what you're going to do.
Yeah.
Being a woman talking about feminism, like that's expected. But as you said, for change to happen, for us to really move forward, you need everybody else to be in on it, to be in
yeah.
on that conversation and on that action.
Yeah.
In my book, How to Be Black, I still give credit to the best moment in that book wasn't what I wrote, it was just what I pulled out of someone else, who's W. Kamau Bell, who now hosts the CNN show United Shades of America, which you should all watch. It is really, he goes there in like such a literal and awkward, sometimes and painful sense, hanging out with Klan members, going to prison and beyond. But he, you know, I asked everyone in my book, what do you want for the future of like racial life in America? And he said, I want every group to have to move one over, basically like shift one lane over. So I want the black people to have to advocate and fight for the immigrant community. I want the immigrant community to have to advocate and fight for LGBTQ. I want them to have to advocate and fight for women, et cetera, et cetera. So you, when you really walk in someone else's shoes, you understand what justice really is. You understand what human
yeah.
rights really are.
Sure.
And you can't advance a more just racial world and make a less just sex, gendered world,
sure.
right? Or a less just sexual orientation world. We have to move yeah. it all forward together. So that was, he said it even more beautifully than I slightly butchered then. You should definitely check the book out, or just watch a show or follow him on Twitter.
Yeah.
Just think about him often, all the time. But that spirit needs to happen more in action. So this is a long-winded way of saying
yeah,
thank
well,
you.
Well, I think, yeah, it is. And I think, you know, change is, you know, change is so, unfortunately, it's so hard to make. I mean, you know, if you look at the country's racial and racist history and structures, and, you know, it's still happening today.
Mm-hmm.
You know, think laws that were, you know, changed, you know, it's like, kind of like when you're, I think a lot of it comes also to education, where it's like, you know, when you bring up the term white privilege, you know, some people get turned off by
it. Did it ever turn you off? Like, and when you first heard it,
I first
did you get
heard it actually
like,
a couple years
what privileges
ago.
Privileges do I have? Like,
and I didn't fully grasp it when I first heard it, because when you think of privilege, I think of rich white kids, you know, and I've never viewed myself as a rich white kid, you know. So, and then you think also of privilege as being treated better than you're supposed to be treated,
mm-hmm.
and I think with the term white privilege,
I think there's maybe a couple levels of it, you know, when you're referring to it, because sometimes there are situations where white people are just treated much better. But there's also many situations where it's worse than just that. You know, it's not just white people being treated better, it's black people and other people being having their human rights violated, you know, and having crimes against them, which to me is like, that's just a basic civil right. You know,
not having that happen to you isn't a privilege.
Right, exactly. That shouldn't be a privilege.
It's just like basic, right?
So that was, when I first heard the term, that was, you know, something I thought was a little like maybe it's not covering it enough, you know what I mean? But I think all that falls under it, but, you know, there's different, you know, levels of it, you know, so.
Do you think, I'm going to ask you to speak for all white people right now?
Never do that, because I've, you know, I mean, I've been treated like shit by everybody, you know, over the years, you know,
of
all kinds. Yeah, no, but you know, everyone, you know, there's good people and bad people of all kinds, you know, and I've been treated well and poorly by everybody. And, you know, and certainly, you know, there's more white people in this country. I've certainly been treated worse by more white people than anyone else.
There
you know?
Go. But, that's a wrap.
That's a wrap. But, you know, it's, but I remember, but then, you know, sometimes you think, oh, you know, you can be like, oh, all the white people are bad people. I remember I had to take a cab last night, and the cab driver was a woman, and I'm not sure what country she was from. Yeah. And I figure, oh, this is gonna be so cool. She's probably really great. She tried to rip me off on the ride, you know, and then I got into an argument with her. Because I swiped my card, and then she says, it didn't go through, but I saw it flash up there saying, would you like a receipt? So I know it went through. So she hit something on there, and then she was trying to it was just really weird. So I was like, okay. So I was giving her the benefit of the doubt. So I was, beforehand, I was thinking, oh, this lady's got to be some great lady, but she was a fucking asshole. You know, so
women can be assholes too.
Well, you know, it's just, you know, you can't prejudge or predict the future or anything. You know, so.
I love how that story led to, you're not a psychic. That's great.
Yeah, I know.
That's
a lot of people think I am.
You're not psychic. What do you, in your, God, this is so exciting. I just got stuck with like a moment of like, I'm talking to a white person on stage about race. This is great. We've done it in our podcast too. It's not like the first time it's ever happened, but it's just, there's clearly a spotlight right now.
Well,
in your awakening, shall we say, your own education, like you speak really, from just the last few minutes, you're not resistant to the concept. You're like, white people have work to do. Like, this country's history isn't all it's caught up to be. How was that process for you? Did you just like snap in like this? Did you have a crisis of consciousness?
I think I've been aware of that since I was a kid. Yeah. You know, I mean, it's pretty, I when I was a little kid, I went to a magnet school, so it was a lot of people from all different backgrounds. Mm-hmm. And then...
what city was this?
That was actually in San Diego. I went to a magnet school in San Diego. So there weren't a lot of Asian people, but there were a lot of black people, a lot of Mexican people. So, you know, it was pretty mixed. Mm-hmm. And then I remember I was born in Maryland, then we moved back to Maryland, and that school was mostly white. That school was mostly white, the elementary school that I went to there. And the middle school was a little more mixed. And then my high school was quite mixed. My high school was, I think it was about 30% black and a pretty fair amount of Asian, not much Latino. And then the white people there were a mix of low income white to middle, and then probably a little bit of upper middle class too. So it was pretty mixed. And but you know, since I was a kid, you know, my parents were always, conscious about, treating everybody with respect, you know, and, you know, people come from different backgrounds and treating everyone well, you know, and also even in sports, you know, I was really big into soccer, and, you know, I was on the state team, and I was so passionate about it.
I get it, you're a world champion.
Yeah, I was a great athlete. So, anyways, but
when
soccer is a world game. It's a very international game. So I had coaches from Haiti. I had coaches from Hungary, from Trinidad, from Europe. And I played, you know, and had teammates from people from all over the world. So, it's kind of, I think things like that are helpful too, you know, so. And then you see the ugly side of things too, and it, I remember always just kind of, you know, when you see something racist or ugly, it's just, I don't know, it's just, I can't, it just, it's always been a turnoff, you know, and it always kind of, and even today, it always surprises you a little bit, even though you know it might be coming, but you don't always know when it's coming. It always surprises you and catches you off guard, you know.
One of the, when I think of the term, I think there's, it's an unfortunate combination of words in some way, for some of the reasons you talk about white privilege, because it sounds like special access.
Right, but it's sometimes like, it like is special access. Like right, if you look at the mostly, Stanford it's, but
mostly
it is.
Mostly it's right. Basic rights.
Right, it's human rights part, that are being violated. Like,
oh, yeah. How people should be treated. It's right. Not an extra right. Well, then
some
credit.
Of, but some of the privilege is historical, like the GI Bill. I'm forgetting exactly what year that was, but it was after World War II, mm-hmm. where white soldiers coming back were given, you know, very good deals with low mortgages on houses to make it easier for them to get houses, and black soldiers coming back, for the most part, couldn't partake of any of those advantages. Mm-hmm. So that's an example of white privilege, but if you go back to the mid-40s, and white people were able to buy a house, and a lot of black people were not able to buy a house, that's not that long ago. That probably still has repercussions mm-hmm. today. So there is privilege existing, you know.
So what do you, speaking for white people?
Mm-hmm. No, I don't. I speak for me.
No, I'm putting this on you right now.
I know.
What are you gonna do about it?
Well,
what do you think should be done about it?
You know, I think, you know, the two big things are talking to people who are different than you, who don't know you, and listening to them, you know. And then for whatever your beliefs are, is expressing your beliefs, you know. I stopped by a Black Lives Matter protest last week, and you know, there might have been 1,000 or 2,000 people there, but why weren't, there's, what, 8 million people in the city? Why wasn't there 1 million people there? Mm-hmm. You know, it takes, you
because
know,
Pokemon Go got released last
right.
week.
Right, and but also it takes, you know, it's a lot of work, you know, and also when you make a big statement, you know, standing up for anything, no matter what it is, you know, there's, you worry about, oh, what are other people going to think about me, you know, and stuff like that, you know, and a lot of people do that, no matter what it is, you know, so.
Let me.
But I think you got to do it.
For those running with the cards, if you could bring a batch up, if anything's in, if you have them, pass them to the. I would want to dive into the crowd for a minute and see what's on your mind, so it's not actually just us talking. That'll help set this up a little bit. I got a theory, a partial theory, and I think I can't take full credit for this. And partly it's in conversation with my girlfriend. Partly it's just realizing that facts alone and information alone won't do anything. Because we have all the technology, we have all the potential to know anything we want to know, and some people don't want to know, right? Truth is very painful. But in terms of what should and could be done, I think there's a basic step. I think as I've gotten older and gotten to know and interact with more and more white mainstream society, I have realized how miseducated we all have been.
Yeah.
And I think there's a popular story that, like, the education that, like, black and poor people in this country get is subpar and substandard and inadequate, and that white kids get this, like, creme de la creme education, and they're all kind of going to Harvard. That's not true. I'm the one that went to Harvard. Lord. You know, in this particular case, but I think writ large, we've all been duped.
Yeah.
And I think, so there is a miseducation that cuts to whiteness that is very subtle. And it leads to believing certain things that aren't true. It leads to being shocked
sure.
by
yeah.
facts.
I mean, just if you look at the way school's taught, yeah. I mean, if you look at, they taught Lincoln is the guy who ended slavery. And now they just move on to the next subject. So that acts like, oh, well, then that was it. Case solved, no more problems, you know? It's like, hey, Martin Luther King gave this great speech. Unfortunately, he was assassinated. That was sad. But then the civil rights era movement ended. And then, you know, Vietnam happened, you know? So it's like they don't. And then I remember when I first started reading Howard Zinn's book, the People's History of the United States, and it's like, you read that and you're like, holy shit, you know, this is I think almost everything I learned in school historically was a lie, you know. You know, there's this very, you know, if you look at, like, I think so much of the school, at least when I went to school, I don't know what what the school is for kids today, but it's like there's this heroification of everything. You know, Christopher Columbus, he discovered America. You know, I do a whole long bit about Columbus discovering America, how it's our most awkward holiday, you know. Like, he's the guy who discovered America, even though there was already a million people living here for thousands of years, and he called them Indians because he thought he landed in India, but he fucked up and landed in America. But they just kept calling them Indians, and they pretty much slaughtered all the Indians. And we have a holiday celebrating that guy. It's kind of weird. It's like, how should we really celebrate Christopher Columbus Day? And then I do this bit where I'm like, you know, when you're in an elevator and you're up on a high floor and you're going back down the lobby, and the elevator's crowded, you know, and but you don't realize someone else has pressed floor 3, so. You know, instead of getting off at the lobby, you just get off on floor 3, and then you're like, oh, guys, sorry. Then you walk back in the elevator, and your guy's like, sorry, I'm a fucking idiot. I thought it was a lobby. So instead of, like, admitting that, you're like, no, you just stay on floor 3, and you pretend that's the lobby, and then you murder everyone on floor 3. Like, that's how we should celebrate Christopher Columbus Day. You know, just an idea, you know. Yeah. So, but it's like, so... You know, so there's so many, you know, there's, and I also think the way culture is today, it's so hard to have a discussion with so many people, because so many people, no matter what it is, not even if it's race, and race is a very...
Well, that's easy. Race is the easy subject.
But that's, you know, that's such a, you know, it's such a heavy subject, but anything, I mean, you go on Twitter and you say, I like this TV show, then people write back, fuck you, that show sucks, you know. It's like almost everyone has like a 5-year-old mentality where they're eating broccoli for the first time and they're like, yuck, and then they throw it on the ground. And like that's the way people act with everything. It's like nobody listens, you know, and nobody thinks, you know, it's like it's okay to have different opinions on things, mm-hmm. you know. But I don't know. So sometimes I'm really hopeful, and then sometimes I'm really pessimistic at the same time.
I think there's a we could probably make a new word out of optimism and pessimism.
I'll combine the two.
Possimism. Yeah, pessimism. Like, you're like, maybe possibility. Like, maybe it's possible, maybe it's not.
But then there's people who are going to be pessimistic that would actually take off. So.
Yeah. There's a, but I think, going back to my earlier point, I think there's just steps to it. And there's, I think this country has done a really good job of programming most of its citizens to never look back. We're founded on this, like, always look forward, like you're running from something, the future's always brighter, and that's, it's nice to believe in that, because it means you can ignore yesterday's pain, and who wants to wallow in yesterday's pain? Like, in an individual sense, you don't want to do that. At a collective sense, what would that involve? Like, that would involve a serious, it's like a very emotionally deflating prospect to actually be honest about what's happened, and to acknowledge that maybe a lot of the stuff I have is not entirely exclusively due to my great work ethic and genius. Like, maybe just a smidgen of it is due to sacrifices made by others and advantages taken of others who came before me. So that acknowledgement itself is a huge, huge step. Yeah. And I suspect that the true acknowledgement of that would be a devastating emotional and psychological blow to people. I think we are, like, when we can't lose the weight we want to lose, we lose our shit. When our TV shows get canceled, we go nuts.
Yeah.
And we were talking about, like, your sense of self being canceled. You're talking about your nation's history being canceled. What are your thoughts about the emotional cost of really diving into what white privilege, or even other words that kind of approximate that, and a true acknowledgement would mean?
I think it's good, you know. I mean, you know, it's just like, you know, for people who are like, are against affirmative action, you know, they'll be like, or they're against welfare, you know, and they're like, oh, that's gonna hold me back. I'm like, no, anyone getting lifted up should lift up other people too. You know, it's like, you should want, anytime, you know, someone is doing well on something, you shouldn't look that as a threat to you. They, you know, if they're doing well, you know, they might be able to help you too.
That's a very optimistic view.
So, I mean, I think that's the way you have to look at things.
All right, I'm going to try to read this card. Okay. It says, and if I do this terribly, would you stand up and re-represent yourself accurately? What can incentivize or compel, and the word compel is underlined, masses of white people to engage in serious exploration and work, re white privilege?
We got a lot of guns in this country that they're very effective at compelling people to action. If you ask this question, if you want to elaborate, feel free to stand up. If you want to hide behind the writing at school too, I don't want to. Right here.
You got it. Okay. It's pretty straightforward. What do you all think would really bring large amounts, not just a few little marginal folks, but large amounts of white people to the table to really deeply grapple with?
Free stuff. Yeah. TV cameras, a record deal, Twitter followers, Instagram likes, some kind of validation, right? I think there is a cultural element to this, and I didn't even finish thinking through my earlier point, but I think there's a level of facts and information that we got to deal with because of the miseducation. There's a level of emotion and pain diving and something more spiritual, and this is what I was getting to, I can't take full credit for that. I think, honestly, the whole nation needs to do. I think there's something, as black people especially, we've been rooted in that for so long. Like, we have carried pain across generations. We have a lot of practice at pain. We created the fucking blues. Like, we know pain. And I think white people, because of the system, not that no white people have ever experienced pain, but as a collective in this country, it's been written to avoid that. It's been written to rewrite the story of straight-up victory and earned this and that. So I think there's some emotional component. And then the incentive thing you're talking about, what would actually draw more people, because you're frontline, like you're wearing this t-shirt, like you're not normal, right? You're not a normal white person. And I say that as a compliment.
Yeah, no, it's okay.
I say that as a fact. I think most who are in this room probably aren't.
People say that to me and they mean it as a compliment or as a non-compliment. It's totally okay.
So I think
you know, it's like, you know, I remember I started a, about 15 years ago in the city, stand-up comics in the city, people don't realize what low pay they get, you know. If you go on the road, you can actually get paid what you're worth. You can make good, if you're a big draw, you basically get paid as many people as you draw, you know. But in the city, even the top and biggest comics, if they're working the comedy clubs in the city, they're getting anywhere from $0 to $30 a night for a show. Yeah. And on the weekends, they're getting about $75 a show. So if I do a show at a comedy club on the weekend, I'm getting $75. If I'm doing a show during the week, I'm getting anywhere from $0 to $30. So some of the clubs are, you know, making a lot of money. So about 15 years ago, we're trying to get comics to come together to try to, like, back then the pay was 50 or 60. We were trying to get it raised, and the comics hadn't gotten a raise in about 25 years. Mm-hmm. You would be shocked at how you would think everyone would just come together on this. You know, it was so fucking hard to get everyone to come together on an issue that benefits everybody. Mm-hmm. So when you're talking about, you know, an issue where you want to help black people, it's like, I think it makes it even harder, unfortunately, because it's most people just don't want to fucking help people. You know, And I think most people are scared, you know, and I think fear is a big part of it. So I think the more people start speaking up and taking action and doing things, even if it's little things, I mean, it's a fucking t-shirt. That shouldn't, you know, that shouldn't even be, we shouldn't even be in a society where wearing a Black Lives Matter t-shirt is a big fucking deal, you know, it shouldn't be, but that's, you know, it's, people look at it as like, oh, it stands out.
When it's,
you know,
a shirt that frankly there shouldn't exist.
Right,
it's
of
the
course.
Most redundant statement right. ever.
Like, you shouldn't have to put anything before lives matter.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
You shouldn't have to. You know,
I think there's also this is a good question.
So I think just, you know, being vocal, you know, and getting out there. Sorry.
Yeah, yeah. That was a great example of it.
Exactly.
The president talked about this in his memorial remarks in Dallas just yesterday. You know, he's a big believer in, we've made great progress, like, life is better today than when I was a child, and we all have to be willing to come to some shared table and be a little less ready to bite somebody's head off and be a little less judgmental right off the bat. And I think he's in part right. I think there is, you know, not that the oppressed have to appease the oppressor, but there is a, maybe some demilitarized zone, like there's a timeout zone where it's like, this is a safe space for everybody to be ignorant, to be unafraid to ask a question that could come across as possibly racist or unknowing or foolish or stupid. Not all day, every day, and not with guns and badges and the power of death as implemented by the state, but in a rhetorical fashion at least, some convening that allows for that. Because I do know, I got a lot of practice being around white people at this point, and I know that it's not really about individual hatred. Like, this is well beyond that. It's a much more subversive and systemic thing. But I also know the awkwardness of, like, I don't want to be called racist. Like, that's worse than racism in a weird, perverse way. Like, it's this shame thing. It's like Game of Thrones. You're going to be stripped naked. People are going to throw poop at you as you walk down the MTA steps. So one thing is, I think there's a possibility to try to create more inter-ethnic spaces to allow for awkwardness and just promote, like, hashtag, it's okay to be awkward right now. 30 minutes, cool, or a day, or whatever. And then the other is more like white ambassadors. Like, there's some kind of, I know white people hear messages from other white people a little bit differently because of what we talked about. Like, it's expected for someone like me, who's been, like, talking raced up as a professional Negro forever. But if you hear a white person, it's like, oh, that's presidential. Like, it's just different, right? It's just like, and that's not a judgment, it's just a fact. Like, we all hear messages differently from people who kind of look like us. And I think there's something different to having the each one teach one method of, like, white on white conversion therapy and, like, to bring your brothers and sisters into this. Because coming from, like, just women talking about feminism and, like, gender equality, like I said, not going to cut. Like, you need dudes out there in the front lines, too.
Yeah.
And so as we think in that Kamau, like, lane-shifting way, I think there's something to that, to answer your question.
You but, know? You know, talking about what you were just talking about with, you know, white people talking to white people, that doesn't work a lot. There's all different kinds of white people, and there's... And, you know, they all hate each other a lot in many ways, you know. So, I mean, if I ever tweet something, whether it's a joke or a serious statement, whether it's about war, whether it's about race things, you know, not 100% of the time, but 80% of the time, I always get somebody trolling me back. And it's always a white person with something, you know, really, really nasty and scary, you know.
Yeah.
Always, you know. So. But I think, you know, I think racism has risen in this country since Obama got elected.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's because for the people, because like you said, there's also all different kinds of racists, but for the people who are out racists, you know, they're active out racists, you know, they're not unintentional racists, they're not blind racists, they're not in the closet racist, but people who are actively racist, I think, you know, their worst nightmare happened. You know, a black guy got in the White House, and they've become, I think, more motivated, more organized, more active, mm-hmm. and angry and scared. You know, so I think it's kind of risen some. You know.
Yeah, no, it's
unfortunately,
the truth has been revealed, and it's not the myth that we believed. About ourselves, and that's a little sad and a little revealing at the same time. Here's a card from, we didn't actually put your name, so I'm gonna do this again. Can you guys discuss the dynamic of being the only black person in a writer's room? Definitely want Judah to take this one. or creative space versus having a truly diverse group in your surroundings. Thank you. And if I don't do it justice, you know, stand up and hold me to account. Actually, I am curious about your experience on that, but I'll take the first stab at it. So, I have been in two major media institutions that have had writer's room. I was at The Onion for 5 years when it was here in New York from 2007 to 2012. And I used to joke that I was all the black people in The Onion in terms of the photo work that they do. Like, I was Obama, I was the Supremes, all three Supremes. Photoshop is amazing. And so I was like a universal Negro, like it was just like a plug-in. And but from a race dynamic there, I was very impressed with these white people because there was a level of thought and discussion and debate about like why are we doing what we're doing. And I would find it really interesting there were people who didn't work there who assumed that like a story that ran was something that I planted. Like when Obama got elected, The Onion's headline was "Black Man Given Nation's Worst Job," and that's just true, right? Like we have so much quantitative and qualitative evidence to support that psychic observation, and that was a white person, because these white people were like they listened as well, and so race wasn't the only thing that was important. It was like mindset that allowed that institution to survive 20 years and kind of attack and represent everybody. It's not always the case, And I think there's, you know, the other place has been The Daily Show, where I was recently until the middle of May, helping relaunch it under Trevor. And my first day on this show, having been used to being the only or one of the few dark faces, much less black faces, in rooms like that, I walked into a room where I wasn't the first or the second or the third or the fourth. I was the fifth black person in the room, which in a room of 35 people, still a vast minority, but in media, that's like a coup, right? Like, that's somebody's nightmare. Like, that's like, oh my God, the Black Panthers are taking over the fucking Daily Show. And there's legit Africans too, not just like American, not hyphenated black, like pure, unadulterated blackness from Mother Africa was up in this room with Trevor, you know, with Joseph Opio from Uganda, with David Kabuka from South Africa, Trayvon Free from Compton, and me from DC. And Jessica Williams was late that day. Like, it was a total day. And she's just that badass. She can do whatever she wanted to do. And so those numbers meant something. And I think it led to some pieces that you see under this version of The Daily Show that you couldn't have seen under a different version. And that's not a judgment call, it's just an observation. There is, however, still the one thing that's consistent across, and I've found not just in a writer's room, but there can be a lot of blindness among do-gooding white people of a self-congratulatory nature.
Sure.
And it's like, oh, we voted this way, therefore we're all good, right?
Yeah.
We live in this neighborhood, therefore we listen to this music, therefore we get this like easy pass to cut through all the toll booths without thinking. And so I think that the way that race shows up and some racist things can show up isn't some old-fashioned, clanny, alt-right Twitter hate. It's this like presumption of knowing best. It's this like, oh, we could never be wrong. Like, it must be something else going on. And when race is brought up, like, how is that the explanation? I really think it's this other thing. So it's more subtle. It's a little more under. You know, it's the texture of it is really different, and it messes with your head. I'll speak for me. It messes with my head sometimes. I'm like, was that a race thing, or am I crazy? Like, and I am a little crazy. Like, you have to be to like be in this planet, in this country, but I wouldn't think I was that crazy.
It's almost like gaslighting, in a sense. The term gaslighting.
Break that down. I think
it's where, like, someone's done something wrong to you, but then they convince you that you've actually done the thing that's wrong. You
know? So I think there's something about a certain type of liberal, you know, progressive whiteness that means there's a shield, like, I can do no wrong, and everything I do is all good, and I'm down, and I use this hashtag, so that's that. And so the problem with that is that it's a little harder to point at, and it means people who think of themselves as allies are actually very resistant to any kind of criticism.
Yeah. Well, look
at
the...
And it's very tense and awkward in those cases.
Yeah, look at the... I remember one on Colbert's show, mm-hmm. when he was doing a bit, and... he was doing an anti-bigotry bit, but he was using Asian racial slurs he was doing it. And Sui Park, I believe is her name, on Twitter, started the hashtag Cancel Colbert and called him out. And basically, she was saying, why are you using Asian racial slurs? Yeah. And so many people jumped on her saying, Colbert is one of the good guys. It was an anti-racist bit. But her point was an interesting one, which is like, of all the races you could have chose, why did you choose the Asian racial slurs?
Why were you the default punching bag?
Right, because if he had done black racial slurs, he would have gotten really bad feedback. You know, but at the time, doing the Asian racial ones, they were thinking, oh, that's not going to happen. They're not going to say anything. And I think, you know, she had a very valid point there. You know, I don't think the Colbert show should have been canceled, but that was a very good conversation to have. Or even when Bernie Sanders last year, I think about a year ago, was speaking in Seattle, and two women jumped up on the stage, Black Lives Matter activists, mm-hmm. and people were like, why are they protesting Bernie? He's a good guy, he's on your side. And then all the people, and it was, you know, pretty much an all-white crowd, started booing them. They said, well, you're kind of proving our point right now. But the thing is that, like, and they're like, well, it wasn't polite what they did. And you know, it's like, for my point of view, and I think other people's point of view, it's like, change doesn't happen easy. You know, there's no
you know, just because Bernie might be one of the good guys doesn't mean you shouldn't have that conversation.
And it doesn't mean a good guy can't be off or wrong.
Exactly.
Or
and at the beginning,
not know everything about everything all the day.
And that and what those women did actually did change his platform, mm-hmm. because initially he was like, nope, it's all economic stuff. We don't have to talk about the race stuff. And after that, he did started bringing racial stuff into his platform more, at least, you know. So it's like it. You know, I remember I was reading several years ago. I was reading "Hope on a Tightrope," and you know, they're talking about. And I also read one of Ai Weiwei's books, and you know, and talking about, you know, like change. It's like what Hillary said. The best way to make change is basically through bureaucratic incremental changes. It's like no change. Whoever's in the power is never going to just give you anything. Anything that we've ever had in this country, whether it's black people's rights, women's rights, gay people's rights, none of it just happened. It was always fought, you know, with protesting, marching in people's lives. It was never given to anyone. So it's like, so when they jump on the stage, the Black Lives Matter girls jumped on the stage, and it wasn't smooth, it was awkward. It's like, that's okay. It's like change is awkward, you know, and you have to fight for it. So,
I thought that was funny.
Why is Baratunde asking all the questions? Would love to hear more from him about the topic.
Brooklyn Historical Society, you guys are great.
I guess I'm not good at asking questions. Sorry. Just yell out questions too.
Yeah, you can do that too. You can do that too. I thought this would rope in some different things, but microphones are moving about. I just made that up. That's not true at all. There are no microphones.
Just yell it out.
I thought she had a mic. She has a piece of paper.
Does anyone have a question? Just yell it out.
Why don't you read this one?
Really?
Yeah.
See, I don't know if I just have to read here.
Can you not read? Is this where we're going to discover?
I'm a slow reader, man.
The world champion
sort of
is illiterate.
Is our system, democracy and capitalism, even capable of delivering the necessary change for the true liberation of peoples when the very nature of the principles held? See, this would be much better if they asked the question, because I'm not good at reading.
Who was that? Okay,
yeah,
go ahead.
Ask the question.
I'm just curious, like, what your thoughts might be on the fact that, like, capitalism and democracy, like, by their nature, are exclusionary, and, like, there's an inherent tyranny in both of those things. So when we talk about, like, the true liberation of people, like, is our system as it's currently set up even capable of delivering that kind of liberation that people actually seek?
That's a great question, and, you know, I think a lot on the political right, you know, they're always putting on blames on things, you know, whether, you know, if you look at Trump, it's the Mexicans, it's the Muslims. People never, you know, I think our country in general, we're really good at looking out the window and blaming someone else, but we're not good at looking in the mirror and seeing what we've done or what our whole system is, you know. So, capitalism is a... Capitalism, I think, by definition, means a lot of people are going to get fucked over. Yeah, so it's like...
I would...
The people that are, like, decrying socialism are the ones who are often getting fucked over by capitalism, but they'll blame it on the Mexicans instead of blaming it on capitalism. Yeah, that happens a lot. Yeah, so...
They're different things. I don't know... I'm glad you asked for two, like, capitalism and democracy. I think we've seen... Our version of capitalism isn't the only way. And I think it's, we've chosen to have this really tilted system. We've chosen to let democracy be defined mostly by bottles falling on the floor and interrupting the flow of a really smooth answer to a question, but then segueing neatly back into it.
And I think we have a
order to get to the larger point that democracy isn't capitalism, but even our capitalism isn't the only way to do it.
Yeah.
And when we have...
It is a sort of democracy that we have. It's a sort of democracy.
It's a sort of, but America, we're just so fucking high on ourselves. Like, we're feeling ourselves a lot. And when we talk about capitalism,
So compound interest, right? A key tenet of like economic growth, like returns on returns on returns, stacks on stacks on stacks, to use hip hop. And you will grow based on your starting point and your starting principles, and that trajectory will continue. And that can be beautiful if you started with something beautiful. That can be hideous if you started with something hideous. And I think we're in between, right? We started with some real beautiful words. Really, like, that Constitution is pretty dope, most of it. The three-fifths clause, not so much, but largely. And you had to update some of the language, like get some firmware updates to the Constitution. We could get a pretty good operating system here. But we have also undermined, you know, ourselves in the process of trying to live that out. And we haven't been honest about the faulty core in our versions of democracy and in our version of capitalism. So we're going off on this trajectory, compound growth on like some bad kernel, some bad start. I don't think there's something truly in the nature of democracy that means people can't be free. Or even maybe in the nature of capitalism, so long as it's actually regulated and all the externalities are internalized and like you can't just exploit without accountability. A true free market, like people have really good information, right? There's fairness enforced. The laws are equally applied in a true democracy, like it's equal protection under the law. So the ideal is pretty good. The execution against that ideal leaves a lot to be desired, and our dishonesty about how much we fail to do that in favor of mythology and nice-sounding songs and flag-waving makes us much worse off because we keep compounding on bad interests. Yeah. That was very serious. Jesus Christ.
I was going to say the exact same thing. Very well said.
How would you explain white privilege to a white person who doesn't believe it?
That's the key question. Well, you know, I think we've already covered this some, but it's some people aren't going to believe it, you know, no matter what you're talking about. You can't, they're set, they're stuck, you know, or they're committed to their, you know, to their way of thinking. And, you know, there's all kinds of propaganda out there, and if people believe one thing, they're going to believe it. You know, I think, you know, some of the things we've talked about earlier, you know, talk about the structural racism in the history of the country and how that there's still repercussions of that today. I mean, if you look at, you know, just look at segregation in the South, that's, you know, that's not that long ago, you know, it's, you know, so, I mean, everyone should know. It's like there's all kinds of privilege, too. You know, good-looking people, I think it's been proven, usually get raises easier than so-called not good-looking people. You know, overweight people get picked on more than people who are not overweight. You know, so it's like there's all kinds of stuff going on. You know, men still get paid more than women for doing the same job. There's all kinds of privilege. So it's out there. And I think, you know, with... You know, if you can factually tell people things and do it in a firm but nice and open way, then it's up to them to whether they're going to take it or not, you know. And sometimes it takes a lot of that. It doesn't take one talk. It might take, you know, 100 or 1,000 talks or more because people have been fed. If people have one ideology, they've probably had it for a long time. So that's a very hard thing to you know, it's just like in this country, if you look at racist laws that were written in the country, the people who wrote those, they spent a lot of time working on it, and they happened a couple hundred years ago, so some of them, so it's, and there are still repercussions of them. It's gonna take a long time to get those to go through, but you know, things could be faster. I don't know.
We should just switch everybody's Facebook feed and have them see what other people see, and maybe eventually with the technology, you can actually feel the extra processing time. Like, you know, your computer gets slow or your phone starts to choke and you're like, oh, I gotta delete some of these apps, I gotta get rid of some of these photos. Like, an element of white privilege is having more RAM, right? Where your phone just moves a little faster because you're not as choked up on some extra processes that are running. And like, why is my phone so slow? Your phone's moving real fast. Because I have a lot of extra shit on my phone that came pre-installed that I didn't ask for. And like it's malware installed on my phone, and that's white supremacy in America's racist system. And I need some work to deinstall it. You also have some shit on your phone And because your phone's working so dope, you don't notice it, but you have some malware in your phone too. And so we need some like antivirus stuff in our phones, and some of that's our laws and some of that's our souls.
Hi, my name is Kepler. My question revolves around being equal. I've come to a point in my life where I see that everyone trying to be equal takes away from what everyone is. Like, for instance, black people, they've had much of their history taken away, reorganized, and re-implemented within their own social environment. And through my perception, through my experiences, I see that most black people don't want to accept much of what we've accumulated from our ancestors. Like, they don't want to accept and respect our history. You know what I mean? They'd rather assimilate more into the American culture and be equal amongst all the other people instead of being, in a sense, equitable. You know, seeing things through a fair sense or plane. So my question would be, do you think that trying to be equal might be an issue, might be a problem in this whole movement towards, you know, everyone being fair? Because in essence, a man, for instance, a man and a woman, they have particular strengths, right? You can't, in my head, you can't tell a woman you shouldn't have a child. That's a man's job. Let a man, you know, have a child. You know what I mean? Because a woman was born with certain strengths. Same thing with a man. Certain strengths and weaknesses. So do you, any of you guys think that it might be trying to be equal might be the issue and not being fair with what we were all born with? Just like a polar bear or a brown bear or a black bear, et cetera?
This is getting more interesting.
Well, I think everyone is different and should be themselves, but I think the key is treating everyone equally and with respect.
Right.
And then also taking into effect when you meet someone what their life story might be and their life experiences might be and what their cultural history might be. But everyone's different. Everyone has different strengths and weaknesses. I think that's what makes things great. I would hate to live in a world where everybody was the same. You know, that would be scary.
I don't think polar bears should have human babies. I stand against that. I think my record will show I've always stood against that.
It's true.
Check my Twitter feed. I've never promoted it. It's an abomination. But I think I hear what you're really saying, and I'm not trying to be flippant with your actual real question. There's I think there's sameness that you're talking about. There's equal outcomes. There's equality of opportunity. I also think even on some of what you're hinting at, I think our concept of what people are capable of, you know, we have overridden that time and time again through our history. People have been stronger than we ever expected them to be. People have been more brilliant than we ever expected them to be. We override biological limitations constantly. Otherwise, we'd all be hacking each other constantly. We exercise restraint and control and discipline and creativity. So I don't think there's a way to assure equal outcome. We can do a lot better job of assuring equal opportunity and an equal interpretation of punishment. And there's just so much room between where we're at now and even some perfect ideal of equal outcome, which I don't think is actually that perfect. There's a lot to do before I think we get into any problem areas where we are somehow suppressing something that's natural. And I think we've done that before, and I think we do it for good in a really different way now.
There's a card here someone wrote.
Next.
Can you all discuss the issue of the lack of appreciation for the contribution of black history and culture? As a woman born and raised in Dallas, Texas, I struggle with this when speaking with some of my white friends and colleagues, both at home and in NYC. Cool question.
Yeah, I mean, I think we've addressed it in some way, just in terms of the miseducation thing.
Yeah.
You know, we got Black History Month, which is great, and now Sprite has Tupac lyrics on his cans. I think that's really gonna help move the needle on like a cultural wokeness factor that's gonna just go through the roof. I like the Sprite in you, and you too, Pharrell. That's great. So,
Yeah, I mean, and to your point about the, you know, the Howard Zinn version of history, which is a little closer to truth versus the, like, and then there was Vietnam, and now we have a black president.
Right.
You know, the highly edited, like, jump cut version of American history, which is probably still more of the default, and the fear of, like, people not wanting to promote national shame. And we want to have some kind of national pride. I think it's kind of natural to some degree.
Who asked the question?
Yeah, right here.
Yeah, so...
elaborate.
I think I know what you mean by black history. Culture, what do you mean?
Ooh, microphone over your right shoulder.
As far as culture.
Hi.
Hi.
Okay, so what I really mean with the question is, like, I was having a conversation on Facebook, because obviously I'm here in New York, not in Dallas, with some friends from home, and they were asking, why does everything have to be so separate? Why is there black this and black that? Or why is there a BET versus a WET?
Is it WET?
No.
Oh, I was like, did they actually make white entertainment television? Because I thought it was just called television, but that's cool that they actually named it now.
So I was trying to explain that, you know, BET came about because at the time MTV wasn't supporting or promoting black artists. And so because of that, you know, we had no choice but to create our own. And I went in a little bit deeper and was like, okay, you know, HBCUs, historically black colleges and universities, they weren't ever created to separate. It was just because we weren't allowed to go to Harvard or Yale or, I mean, anywhere else. So Texas A&M, University of Texas at Austin, we couldn't go there. So I was like, well, what choice are you left with if you're here in a country where everybody else is able to take advantage of all these things, but you can't? Well, what are you gonna do, just sit there? No, I mean, you're gonna create your own. So I struggle with really trying to explain, like, a lot of positive contributions that have come out of those establishments and those things, because it's interesting, a lot of HBCUs that I know, at least in Texas, ironically, they do have a lot of white students that attend them, which is cool, you know, that's the goal. It's just, I don't know why it's such a challenge, I guess, to explain that it's a positive, like with Black Lives Matter, right, that was going to be my next thing.
Can I ask you a question in response to you asking us a question, and we can get super meta here? How did, you describe the situation where people are asking and you're explaining, how did these particular white people that you were interacting with, how did they respond to your explanation? Did they accept it? Did they reject it? Did they have more questions? Did they get angry? Did they take their ball and go home? Like, what happened?
There was some rejection at first from some. Some were like, okay, that makes perfect sense. But it was still like, there were still more questions, and they weren't coming out of, like, true curiosity. It was more like, can you explain, or more like, can you prove to me why? And it was just frustrating, because it's like, I don't want to say like it was, like they were intentionally coming at me like negative or whatever the case was, but it's just frustrating because it's like, okay, I went to school in Texas, the same state that basically has changed the textbooks now to say slavery was not slavery, and that the African people that were brought to the U.S. were workers. Okay, no, because we didn't get paid, but whatever. And it was against, we're not going to go into that. But my point is, it's like I spent, you know, my entire life growing up in a state that taught appreciation for everything except for being black. Boom. And so it's like I was trained, I guess you could say, to appreciate everyone else's culture, everyone else's history, except for my own. And it's like, dang, like now, like it's 2016, we're the same age, like we grew up together, like don't y'all have any curiosity about like my culture, like, you know, like what we do or whatever case, like my history, like beyond Martin Luther King and beyond Malcolm X and beyond you being told that the Black Panther movement was just militant and just out to, you know, destroy the government. So that's basically my question. I don't know how to, you know, really.
You did a great job. Thank you. Thank you. That was, I think we need to hear it more than answer your question. That was, thank you. And condolences for what's happening in your city right now and the healing that's going on there. Sincerely, yeah. I think it's
there's a connection between what you raised and this other question, which we sort of addressed, but it's the whole reason we're here, and I think it's where the whole country is in part. Like, how would you explain white privilege to a white person who doesn't believe it?
Yeah.
That the blindness to the fact that the default has been white, that I saw a researcher present a few weeks ago, searches for beauty on Google result in only white faces. That's the default, right? The algorithm has been trained to define beauty, which many cultures interpret in many different ways as just this one way, because it was founded here in America, and the white Western standard has prevailed. That's why there's BET, because the default didn't allow for me. And I think if another person could imagine a world where they never saw themselves at all the mirrors that they did see reflected a more hideous version of themselves back, they were cracked and broken and distorted, you would try to create some new window, some new glass to see through and to see yourself back in. It's survival, it's basic human need. And the beginning of explaining what this is maybe starts with something as simple as, like, that's just a Google search. Like, we're not, we don't even have to say the word slavery. Right, because that's some old stuff. Why are you bringing up old stuff? I didn't own slaves. No, well, but J.P. Morgan Chase, as an institution, probably had, you know, was stealing real estate that was taken from. Like, you could probably trace it back to an economic system, to your capitalism-democracy intertwined point. But I think if you started with, there's a way to relate it. Like, if you never saw yourself as anything but a monster, how do you think you would feel? Or if you shifted it to a gender specific, or to a sports team, like there's some, to Dallas versus some other city, to Texas versus the rest of America, because you guys have a little secessionist streak, I don't know if you noticed that. It was the Republic of Texas. Yeah, it's a great country down there. I love the nation.
Well, I think, you know, when you're saying, you said the question you asked was, your white friend was asking, why is everything, the channels so segregated or something like that. Well, I think unfortunately, I think this country and even this city is much more segregated than people think it is. You know, like legal segregation is not allowed anymore, but actual segregation, I think unfortunately still exists strongly along racial and class lines. I mean, even New York, you know, New York's called, and in my book I have some cartoons that address this where it's like, you know, it's this big melting pot, New York. It's the Big Apple. It's the melting pot. It's like, I don't see a lot of melting going on. I see a pot, and I see a lot of different people in it, but I see barriers, little walls put up between all those different ingredients in the pot. You know, I don't see much melting going on. You know, in Manhattan, like, if you walk around during the day, you'll see everybody, all kinds of people from all over the world, you know. But at night, when people go home, if you look at Manhattan, it's mostly white people and a fair amount of Asian people, you know. It's and a lot of that is economics. And then if you look at the economics of why that is, there's racial, you know, historic reasons for that as well. So it's you know. So it's I think it's weird. You know, we're told this is. We're multicultural, and in a sense we are, in a sense we're also not. We're also separate, which I think is sad. But I think you need. I think talking about it is good. You know, I don't know all the answers, but you have to at least, because if you're not even talking about it, then you're getting absolutely nowhere. But if you're having a discussion, you have the chance of at least making some kind of progress. You know.
We have time for two more questions, I think.
Okay. No. Thank you. You had your hand up earlier. Wait for the microphone, I'm sorry.
I think part of the challenge has to do with reframing how everything's been framed by white people for white people. So language is a good example to me, affirmative action. If white people, like many in my family do, think that affirmative action means people of color and women get something they don't deserve for being people of color and women, I think we have to look at the reframing of that, because the reality is that we white people have been the affirmative action babies throughout the history of our country. So how do we look at the language that we're using? How do we look at reframing that so people can start seeing the reality of what has existed?
Yeah. It's tricky, I think, carefully. Because I, you know, part of, you brought this up with the Obama thing. Like, there is a, part of the reason I think we got Trump is because we got Obama, right? There's a backlash. And Trump isn't so much like destroying the Republican Party as like revealing something that's been there. He's a black light, and he's showing these walls are covered, right? It's disgusting, but it's been there.
He's an, unfortunately, he is an appropriate candidate for this country,
yeah.
You know.
And, yeah. And so I think, you know, there's a, how history moves and how progress happens and like how hard you push and what terms you use to do it and who feels left out, there is a feeling and to some degree a fact of some version of white loss. And I think certainly at the perception level, it looks like everybody else is getting theirs now, right? It's like, oh my, we talking about transgender bathrooms now? Like that feels so low on the list to someone who's been entitled for their whole history. And we have to have a woman president, and she's a damn criminal. Like, you can just, you can see the wheels spinning. And it looks like, okay, we got this black dude, it's a fucking black house now. We're gonna have this woman house. We got the trans, the gay people are getting married, like, the ISIS. Like, it just, your sense of reality. And that's how it works. It's just a hyperlink away from crazy. And underneath of all that, the economic system, that you've relied on and the myths that you've been taught to believe about what you deserve and the promises, like return you're owed and dude, that promise is a sham. That's not working at all. But it's not because of the Mexicans, right? It's definitely not because of the transgender people trying to use the bathroom that they should be able to use. But it's a very emotionally convenient stick to lean on or to beat someone with. And I don't want to just be cavalier and dismiss and be like, well, just get over it, white people. Like, I don't get over pain just by someone telling me. Like, the worst thing you can tell somebody in pain is you're not feeling pain. Right. Get over it. Shake it off. Like, bad coaches do that. Good people send you to the trainer, to a doctor, get you some ice. Like, there is, like, healing is an art. It's not just words, and it's not demands alone. Like, demands are very important. So I, as much as I love agitation and advocacy and activism, like, your question just makes me think about, fuck, this is hard, because people are actually experiencing something real. I think they're lashing out in a way that's ultimately not in their best interest, but who among us hasn't taken to the bottle when we should have gone to bed? Who among us hasn't overeaten when we should have had a salad instead? Like, there are, individually, we know we can act out in ways that are self-harming. Collectively, with all the miseducation we've talked about, that is a natural response. And so it's hard to just fault people and yell at them and be like, well, just accept your privilege. And That's too easy. I don't know what the full answer is, but I know some acknowledgement that your pain exists and is real, and your actions out of it could use some adjustment. And we're here to do this together, and we don't expect an instant response. It's a slower transition than flipping a switch would imply, and certainly there's a lot of justification for impatience on the part of the oppressed. So let's get on that. But people don't move that quickly. Damn. Yeah. Fuck.
A final question? Anybody?
In the front.
Right here.
Oh, sorry, you just actually touched on it, but I was wondering if you could talk about the role of empathy from both sides and how you view that as a tool to move forward.
Yeah, I think empathy is key. I think many people are biologically can't really do it, unfortunately. Is it possible to project this one drawing that I did? It's a human brain drawing. Yeah, so this is a drawing from my book. And this is unfortunately how I think most people are wired, where they spend most of their time fearing and then hating, a little bit of I'm cool. And then the smallest part of the brain says is denial of fear and hate. So unfortunately, I think that's how most people are naturally wired. Not everybody, but I think a majority probably. So I think empathy is really hard for so many people. Until it actually something happens to them, they just don't believe it. I mean, even with killings that have gone on and people see the cell phone videos, a lot of people are now like, oh, wow, that shit really does happen. But there's still people
who come up with excuses saying, nah, this, they must have done something wrong, you know. So it's like there's a lot of people who still don't fucking see it. So
that person.
Yeah, but empathy is key. But so it's hard to. So I think put racism aside. I think so many people in general just they don't have the ability to imagine what someone else is going through unless it actually happens to them. Not even seeing video footage of it actually helps them. Then they might be able to see it. So I think that's something else you're battling that has nothing to even do with bigotry. It's just, unfortunately, that's the way many people are.
You reminded me of something we talk about, unless it happened to me. And a lot of folks have remarked on how fast it seems that we got marriage equality. After a certain point of acknowledgement, it was like, whoa, that was the express train for that particular version of equality. And a lot of, on the conservative side, it was like, oh, it turns out my nephew is homosexual, or my sister, or my uncle, and do we just have to add black people to the family tree to like?
It's a great point.
Is the human race and the human family not enough of an empathetic distance for you to feel a sense of camaraderie and sisterhood and brotherhood with? And you know, the Dallas thing is just ringing in my head with the empathy question. We have this podcast called Show About Race. We're on a bit of a hiatus, but we did a test show today and was talking with Tanner Colby, who's one of he's the main white dude on the show. And just acknowledging that, you know, in terms of all sides and empathy, I have some empathy for police, right? And like, I think I acknowledged something today that I didn't say out loud. I'm like, I'm probably alive because of some police officer that I've never met. Certainly people I know and love are alive. Like, we're in a city that's under constant threat all day, every day. And mostly things don't pop off, for the most part. And we're gathered here together, and like, it's all good. And I think a lot of that's just quiet stuff happening. And then at the same time, like, the system is so actually rigged, right? There's very underqualified people who are too afraid and need their own version of gun control in some weird way before being allowed to act on behalf of the state to kill people. And I just think to be able to be honest about that, to be able to say, like, yeah, I demand more justice. I also acknowledge that you've probably kept me safe. You can hold both of those at the same time. Like, this either-or thing is, I think, a key to this question of empathy. And if we can acknowledge, as you saw in Dallas, before things went crazy, the police were in with the community protesting foul police action. That's like the highest order of humanity right there. Because you can't feel good being a cop, people holding up signs saying like, cops are wrong and stop killing my brothers and sisters. Like, I can't feel good. And so we're expecting some level of superhuman isolation of emotion from action in some cases at the same time. It's like, what do you expect to happen when all you see is images of yourself being killed and distorted through media? So I think it's a great closing question. I think it's a great challenge to leave all of us with. Hopefully we've exhibited some of that. Hopefully you guys will exhibit more in your lives, and thank you.
I'll try to ask more questions next time.
Thanks so much.
Thank you, everyone.
And thank you, Brooklyn Historical Society. Yeah. This is the coolest historical society in America. It's so current, but not historical. It's the Brooklyn Current Society.
Yeah. I hope everyone enjoyed the evening.
Thanks for doing this.
Thank you, dude. Yeah. Definitely.